I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, on the basis of God's mercy, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptance to God, which is a reasonable act of worship. Do not be conformed to this age, but be transformed by the renewing of the mind, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of yourself more highly than you ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body we have many members, and not all members have the same function, so we who are many are one in the body of Christ, and individually we are members of one another. We have the gifts that differ according to the grace given to us, prophecy in proportion to faith, ministry in ministering, the teacher in teaching, the encourager in one encouragement, the giver, sincerity the leader, diligence the compassionate, and cheerfulness. Let love be genuine, hate what is evil, hold fast to what is good, love one another with mutual affection, outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lag in zeal, be ardent in spirit, serve the Lord, rejoice in hope, be patient in affliction, persevere in prayer, contribute to the needs of the saints, pursue hospitality to strangers. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be arrogant, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is noble in the sight of all. If it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave room for the wrath of God, for it is written, "Vengeance is mine, I will repay," says the Lord. Instead, if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink. By doing so, you heap burning coals on their heads. Do not be overcome with evil, but overcome evil with good.
I love musicals. When I was a teenager, I sang with the Ambassadors, a show choir in my high school, belting out tunes from Rent, West Side Story, The Fantastics, or one of my favorites, Aladdin. Gotta keep one jump ahead of the bread line, one swing ahead of the sword. I steal only what I can't afford, and that's everything. So when I told my husband, Matt, that we were doing a three-week series on Les Miserables and that we would be using both live and pre-recorded music from the movie, his first response was, "You're not gonna sing, are you?" On my own, pretending he's beside me. I'll leave it for the professionals to do that. Well, thank you. All right. No, stop. Okay. Oh, very good. All right. As we wrap up our series this morning, I want us to reflect on the transformative power of love and sacrifice that we find in Victor Hugo's Les Mis and in the many adaptations that it has seen over the years. But I also want us to reflect on this beautiful scripture that Frank has read to us in Romans 12. And many people see Romans as a difficult text, and it is, not least because some of it has been used to do some pretty awful things to whole swaths of people. But also, without understanding its political and social context, it has been used to shape our churches in very particular ways over the centuries. I'm usually not someone who likes to cherry-pick scripture passages, but if there's anywhere that you really could do it, you could find a lot in Romans 12. Love must be sincere, it teaches us. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. Share with those who are in need. Practice hospitality. So what does it mean to be sincere in love? I think it goes deeper than the affectionate feelings we experience for one another or that we see on the surface of Eponine's love for Marius. Despite knowing that Marius loves Cosette, Eponine continues to love in the only way that she really knows how. She's not looking for her own happiness, but instead she dedicates herself to this other person, to Marius's safety and well-being. She's demonstrating in her own way a selfless love. And it's this sense of selflessness that we are called to in our connections and relationships with others. And it's not easy to be selfless. And my heart really goes out to Eponine. And we'll talk about that a little bit, but let's listen first as she sings her story of unrequited love.
On my own, pretending he's beside me, all the love I walk with him till morning.
Our first service didn't have a wonderful soloist. Our second service has a wonderful, wonderful soloist who's going to sing that for us right now.
On my own, pretending he's beside me, all alone, I walk with him till morning. Without him, I feel his arms around me, and when I lose my way, I close my eyes, and he has found me. Shines like silver. All the lights are misty in the river. In the darkness, the trees are full of starlight, and all I see is him and me forever and forever. And I know it's only in my mind that I'm talking to myself and not to him. And although I know that he is blind, still I say there's a way for us. I love him, but when the night is over, he is gone. The river's just a river. Without him, the world around me changes. The trees are barren everywhere, the streets are full of strangers. I love him, but every day I'm learning. All my life, I've only been pretending. Without me, his world will go on turning. The world is full of happiness
totally fanboying over here. That was really great. Thank you so much. Thank you. What does it mean to be sincere in love? We are experiencing an epidemic of loneliness in our country. Nearly 1 in 4 adults across the world have reported feeling either fairly or very lonely. Across age groups, people are spending less time with each other in person than decades ago. This is most pronounced in young people aged 15 to 25 who had 70% less social interaction with their friends than pre-pandemic. And our messages on social media and in films like Les Mis share messages that without a romantic partner, or the right economic circumstances, or the right shoes, or at least 10,000 Instagram followers, we are somehow less than, limited, not good enough. What can we do as a church to combat this epidemic of loneliness? Actually, I find our churches are uniquely equipped to help those who are grappling with feelings of sadness, loneliness, and insecurity. You see, the tradition of Jesus is one that emphasizes selflessness, sacrifice, and giving. And this is not the way of the world as it is now, but the vision of a world yet to come, and yet it's one that we can bring about here today. Eponine's journey, like the journey of Valjean, is one in which their lives are transformed by love. Eponine answers a very important question through the telling of her story. How do we respond to those who need our love and sacrifice? For Eponine, it is in choosing to give of her own life for another. Eponine's sacrifice prompts us to consider the depths of our love for others. What are we willing to do for the sake of those we love? It's an important question, especially on a weekend like this one. One of the first things we must recognize is that we are not disconnected from one another. We are interconnected. Many of us desire for our loved ones to be happy and at peace, for our children to be successful and to have what they need to thrive, and most of us hope to live to an old age. And yet we do not always think of these things as we look at those around us. And so this is the primary contribution that we make as followers of Jesus, who get together every week to be with one another. We begin to recognize that we are interconnected. We are part of the same family, because we are family. When one of us hurts, we all hurt. When one of us feels excluded, none of us are truly included. When one suffers, we suffer too. Dr. Vivek Murthy, Surgeon General of the United States, in his advisory on the loneliness epidemic, includes several foundational pillars that frame a national strategy to put an end to the loneliness epidemic. And I just want to mention two of them. The first is in strengthening social infrastructure, things like parks and libraries and other public programs. And I would add to this pillar our churches. Think about our after-school program and some of the stories you've heard about it in just the past few months. Young people who feel comfortable coming here because they know they will be accepted. LGBTQIA+ teenagers who have said, "I feel like I found a place where I can be me." To hear those words in a church, that's huge. The other foundational pillar that the advisory outlines is this: to cultivate a culture of connection. We can no longer afford to be selfish. We must be selfless if we have any chance of surviving together in this world. We must forget the me first mentality. We must set aside ideas that we are separate from one another, especially and most especially in an election year, right? No matter who we are, on the left or on the right, in the center, whether we are Muslim, Jew, or Christian, we are interconnected. We must learn to embrace our differences and celebrate what God has made, not demonize the other side. Or else I fear selflessness will give way to selfishness, and we will miss out on building something truly special, our community. The stories of Les Mis, of Valjean, Javert, Cosette, Eponine, Marius, the Thénardiers, even though they are fictional stories, they illuminate the very real and powerful truths of love, sacrifice, and connection. Over the coming weeks, we will be examining what our church has the potential to become. With a pastoral transition on the horizon, we are tasked with discovering who we are and what we desire to do with the gift that God has given us called Colonial Church. I want to invite us to start with these ideas of selflessness, of putting others ahead of ourselves, of desiring what is best for one another. Even if that means the things we don't like hearing about in church sometimes, like making a change. How might we be open to change in such a way that Colonial Church becomes a place of connection and interconnection, of community, of family, for all people? A place where we are not on our own, but together, doing the work of the church for this generation and those to come. And as I end, I just want to mention, I have a little short-term memory thing, and sometimes I forget whether I've already said something from 20 minutes ago. I don't know if any of you have ever done that, but I can't remember if I forgot to tell you to follow in the announcements about the I Want a Church series. So I Want a Church is going to be a four-week series where we talk about the things that you want Colonial Church to be as we move into this new season, with a new interim minister coming, with Aaron's departure, with a lot of sort of unknowns and things like that, a lot of changes happening. I want us to be involved together in exploring what we want a church to be like together. So if you'll visit the announcements in the crier on the online bulletin, you will be able to find the link that helps you to answer the question, I want a church that, dot, dot, dot. And so I invite you over the course of the next week, because if you don't do it, there won't be any sermons, right? I need your help. Go online and answer the question. I don't need a paragraph, right? Just a sentence. I want a church that, dot, dot, dot. And if you want to tell me at the end of the service what you want a church that is, great. I can't promise you I will remember, since I can't remember 20 minutes ago. But please do that. That way we can have a vision, just like we have a visioning task force. We'll have a vision together to explore over these next 4 weeks of the kind of church that you want to see and be. Thank you for all that you do to be members, to be a community, to be a family here at Colonial Church.